Welcome to yet another session of Atharva Conversation. Today we have with us Sri Sandeep Balakrishna, with whom I have the privilege of interacting on a topic in which both of us share a lot of passion, that is Carnatic music, and particularly about T.M. Krishna. Before I begin and introduce him, let me just lay out the background. Carnatic music has been extolled to the pinnacle of Nada Yoga or Nada Yajna, whereby the sadhaka experiences the sublime and arrests time for the listeners. But in TMK, we have something different and quite the opposite, where through his various non-musical egregious engagements, T.M. Krishna dons upon himself the garb of the soul liberator of this very music itself. Liberate the music from what? If he asks that question, we get to hear or we get to read that he wants to liberate this music from the elements of devotion in it, and simultaneously he presents a cocktail of various things like subaltern theories, alleged prejudiced handling of the music by the upper caste artists, marginalization of certain elements of music, all these that we can see in his arguments in various speeches and through his book. So creating a public narrative concerning music along these fault lines of caste and other dimensions is a well sought after turf by T.M. Krishna. In him, what we get to see is a rehash of all several old arguments exaggerated with contemporary atrocity literature along the fault lines of caste hierarchy, and T.M. Krishna altogether takes this divide to a new dimension of calling for Carnatic music bereft of any aspect of devotion. We had the genius saint Sri Tyagaraja, who composed a very beautiful kriti, Janma Menduku Bhakti Leni Nara Janma Menduku. Whereas we have now T.M. Krishna, who not only tries to separate out the bhakti element from the Carnatic music, he goes a step ahead and says, and I quote, if his main objective was to convey the devotional meaning through the lyrics, he would have probably used repetitive melodic themes for all the compositions in the raga to make the composition more accessible to people. So clearly you can get a glimpse as to what he is hinting at. So this is a brief glimpse of what T.M. Krishna is, and more about it we will discuss today. And as I said, I have the pleasure of interacting today with Sri Sandeep Balakrishna, the founder of Dharma Dispatch, a prolific writer and a public intellectual who does not mince any words in calling out the charade that masquerades in the public domain in the garb of intellectual discussion. And he rightly called T.M. Krishna as the ideological Iyengar. So welcome, Sandeep ji, to this discussion. And let me begin by asking you about what are your, give you a brief overview about your readings of T.M. Krishna, and then we will go about asking questions from my side.
Namaste, Raman. Thank you. First of all, please accept my congratulations. You have, succinctly summed up the whole issue in really brief words, and essentially you've captured the whole crux of the whole issue, summary of the whole issue that we are discussing today about T.M. Krishna and his charade, his various antics in public sphere. The first thing one needs to know about Indian music, Indian classical music, because I don't, I'm sure you also don't make this distinction between Hindustani and Carnatic.
Yeah. Yes.
There are just like, there are just seven notes, Sarigama Padani, that's about it. Mm-hmm. So all music is couched in that and it emanates from that. So Indian classical music is at once deeply personal and highly impersonal and highly abstract. No other system perhaps has this concept of ragalapana, where you just give wings. It is unlimited. It is infinite. You just give wings to your imagination, and it is limited. It is infinite. it is limited only by the limitation of your creativity and your imagination.
Mm-hmm.
This is unparalleled anywhere in the world. So what happens to these seven notes in this system of music? What happens when these seven notes are arranged in a specific order, in a specific structure, inside a musical composition? Like, you know, you just mentioned Tyagaraja, the Trinity, Muthuswami Dikshitar and Shyama Shastri. What happens is that, you know, you give almost like a concrete shape based on the raga system. You give a concrete shape to a composition which has, with a lyric, essentially lyric written by all these composers, has to do with bhava. So when it is just like Sanatana Dharma, where everything is an integrated whole. You can't view these things in isolation. You can't view our poetry in isolation. For example, perhaps it is only in the Indian system that we have, you know, where poems are set to tunes.
Very true.
So no other system in the world, at least those which have survived, no other system has poems which are set to tunes. Now, when you talk about Jayadeva's Ashtapadi, he did not write notation for Ashtapadis, for his Ashtapadis.
Mm-hmm.
Later musicians, they found it so beautiful. Why? Because it has an innate original, you know, it has an innate musical content in it.
True.
So in that sense, the work of these composers who set tunes for the Ashtapadis, it becomes very easy because the music is already embedded in that.
True.
So, and each according to his or her own creativity can, you know, set one Ashtapadi to a different, in a different raga.
Very true.
And do the Swaraprasaram there also.
Mm-hmm.
So what T.M. Krishna is doing, consciously doing, publicly doing, and he declares it as such, is that he wants to destroy this.
Very true.
Of course, he won't say that he's destroying it, but that is exactly what he's doing.
He's doing.
So I think, you know, we can take a pause at this point and then segue into a more deeper discussion.
Definitely. Yeah, so you actually hit at the nail, saying that he wants to destroy this core aspect of, you know, this matu dhatu, whatever you are telling, the lyrical aspect and the tonality aspect. It is the matu dhatu relationship. And he, of course, he goes to destroy it. But I'll come to that a little bit later during the conversation. But let me begin by picking your brain with this, perhaps a tangential question. So bear with me on that. What I want to ask is, see, our tradition, all said and done, the Bharatiya Parampara, is unique in the sense that whenever we needed a reformation, the reformer was never from outside. Mm. It was always from within the tradition that a reformer emerged. So in that sense, do you think that this whole thing that TMK is doing about is kind of a reformation, or is it a charade that he's presenting?
Yeah, well, I mean, I already said that, you know, he's bent upon destroying this whole tradition. So the question of reformation doesn't arise. Mm-hmm. And just to address what you mentioned in the beginning about reformation coming from within and not from an external force. Throughout, one thing we have to understand is that we are the world's Hinduism, Sanatana Dharma, is the world's only surviving and the most ancient civilization. So every strand, every thread in this civilization, every aspect of the civilization has these subterranean interconnection, which is very subtle and you can't, you know, quantify it by writing books or, you know, giving talks or whatever. Yes, all of those things help. But unless you live it, unless you experience them, you know, books and, you know, lectures can only take you so far. That is why the primacy in our tradition has always been on achara or acharana, right? That is practice, living it. So we'll take this as a background and then address this question of reform. Now, why does any society or culture need reform? Because, you know, something, there's a period of stability. There's an element of stability that goes on for a long time. And this stability occurs because the society at large, after a lot of tinkering, trial and error, has found that this is the best method for that period to, you know, kind of ensure harmony and all the other nice things. Mm-hmm. Security, harmony, that from security and harmony, you get what is known as peace, prosperity, economic prosperity. So then there is a period of stagnation after which what you call the evils come in. Mm-hmm. That, you know, this has been stagnated, so my grandfather said this, so I cannot deviate from that, although it is bad or whatever. Mm-hmm. So at every point in our history, when this stagnation has occurred, we had an inbuilt mechanism that comes all the way from Vedanta, mm-hmm. which is applied in practical life, that is in society and culture and all that. So that triggers, you know, a kind of what is known as reformation or reform. Mm-hmm. A group of enlightened people, wise people, all the wise people today have left the public arena, so it's populated only by all kinds of malcontents and crooks. Mm-hmm. So that apart, these wise people would say that, look, this was applicable, A, B, C, D practices or whatever were applicable, say, 100 years ago, 1000 years, whatever, 200 years ago. Mm-hmm. Now, conditions have changed because society is dynamic. Right? You can't stop at one point and say, you know, this thing will last forever. This is how it should always be. It doesn't work like that. History is the best proof. Yeah.
So, deshakala paristhiti. It is kind of
correct.
Taking that into
account. Absolutely. Absolutely. So, once that happens, they have come, all these philosophers, spiritual guides, saints, sadhus, rishis, gurus, all these people said, look, this is over. That is in the past. We don't live in that era anyway. And the method they took to reform it was that they drew from the fount of our own culture, from our own heritage. A bhakti movement, what was it? It was both a reformation and a rebellion.
True.
It was an attempt to reclaim. It is an attempt to reclaim. Right? So, and where did they draw their inspiration from? They drew it from Ramayana, Mahabharata, Puranas, lives of great saints and sadhus and all that.
Very true.
So they refurbished it, and in a language, in an idiom that their contemporaries could understand.
Agreed, yeah.
And at no point in time in Indian history did a revolution, violent revolution, ever occur. If at all a violent revolution as it is understood now, it occurred as a rebellion, especially against medieval Muslim rule. It was a rebellion against oppression and not against its own self. So this is a point that largely is applicable to music also. Now, by adding generous doses of what is known as the toxic ideology called Marxism, T.M. Krishna is claiming that he wants to do this reformation. Reformation, why do you need reformation? Something that Tyagaraja Swami has done in the between the 18th and 19th century. It is very recent. And the same system of music has endured. And Tyagaraja, in turn, he also pays rich tributes to his predecessors. This has always been a tradition. No great saint or any great eminent personality in our culture has said that he is not a Swayambhu. He never, no, none of these people claim that they were Swayambhus. They always said, I am following in the path set by, you know, wise people, rishis, thousands of years back. So he pays tribute to Purandara Dasa. He pays tributes to Bhadrachala Ramdas. He pays tributes to, I think, Chaitanya, if I'm not mistaken. Tulsidas. And he has drawn from that entire tradition to the Purana lore. Without Puranas, Tyagaraja's Kirtanas cannot be understood.
Very true. I mean, that's in fact true for almost all the intellectuals or our rishis of the past, right from the age of what I'm referring to as the written evidences. So Arthashastra stands as one of the earliest written references. After that, Panini Ashtadhyayi. All of them will never say that this is my hypothesis. All of them, they will say, they just compile whatever has been existing from before, after having paid their obeisances to their predecessors, and then they put forth their compilation. So it is in that tradition that Tyagaraja also comes. But
That is also reform, right? In a way, that is also reform. Like you mentioned Arthashastra rightly. What does Kautilya say? That, you know, he cites some 10 or 12 great authorities of statecraft and then he says he doesn't contradict them.
Hmm.
So there's a gentle element of persuasion.
True. To suit the particular time and to suit the moorings of that particular context.
Absolutely. Right.
So just to, you know, dabble upon, extend it a little bit here, the kind of logic what D.M. Krishna uses to, you know, promote himself as a reformer is that he again gives the example wrongly for again Tyagaraja. Because if we were to look at the Sahitya tradition, the Trinity is hailed a lot because they have done something very remarkable in the history or evolution of Sahitya. Because before that, it was all dance and music were never separated out, except for, you know, a few people who were before, the pre-Trinity composers. The point is, the Sahitya having a lot of dance, solfa syllables, dance syllables, or in Tamil what they call it as solkattu. So in the that tradition, this Trinity is hailed because they kind of broke that immense use of solkattu in the Kriti form, and they kind of gave it a purely, they kind of gave a Kriti form. So he said, if you should now look upon that also as a change and revolution. Had it not been done, you would not have been worshipping Tyagaraja. So in same line, I am coming and giving you all this logic. So this is how he presents it. So, I mean, your comments or your take on that?
No, I mean, it is complete nonsense, yeah. I don't know what, see, one thing is clear that P.M. Krishna is a very, he's musically learned. That you can't take away from him. Okay. You know, our thing about his, whatever drama that he's doing is different.
Mm.
But the point is, he is what you call an insider.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So he's a Vidwan and whatever, giving kacheris is not a small job for, and sustaining it for so long, this, it takes some doing, some work and effort. So that apart, what he's trying to do is that he's force-fitting his Marxist theory of revolution and reform and whatever other nonsense he says. That, you know, I mean, if he tries to say that Tyagaraja and the Trinity kind of dismantled that old Solkattu thing, it is based on ignorance, is what I can say. What do you call about, how do you classify Tyagaraja's Utsava Sampradaya Kriti? They can be danced too.
Very true. Very good.
How many Tyagaraja's Kritis are performed by dancers on stage today? Right, and other compositions, there are dance dramas. I forget the name. I think it's about Prahlada's school. Naukacharitam. And Prahlada's
anecdote.
Right. So, all these things are already there.
Yeah. So, it's a nonsense. What he is doing is...
It is complete nonsense. The point what he's trying to do is that he's banking on two major things. A, that thanks to our completely deracinated education system, at the most, what does a child, school boy or school girl learn about Tyagaraja? He was a great Carnatic composer. And he was born somewhere and, you know, he composed some of Kritis and he died. This is all they know. This is all they know. And for these students, learning Carnatic classical music is not even an option. It is considered old-fashioned.
Sure.
So, that is one confidence that P.M. Krishna is banking on. And then the other confidence is the support of his equally ideological friends and fellow travelers. And he obviously has all these toxic platforms like Wire and Pro, that whole network, his MaxSA gang, all that, right? So, he's banking on these two major things. Plus the fact that, you know, he can also sing. He can sing, he can give a proper classical concert for two or 3 hours at a stretch. Right? So he knows the grammar also. He knows both Laksha and Lakshana. And dabbled a bit in Sahitya. And it's good that you mentioned Sahitya. Because that brings me back to the first point which I mentioned in my opening thing. That our music, and including the lyric, you cannot separate bhava from the lyric. You have to have a feel when you're singing the lyric. this tradition, perhaps the greatest and the last exponent of this tradition was Balamurali Krishna. There are a lot of these people who sing with real bhava, but they don't have platforms. They are singing some random temples on Ramotsavam and Janmashtami celebrations, but they don't have these platforms. So you cannot separate bhava from the lyric. And then when you infuse bhava in anything, it could be dance or music or poetry, that is when you get a well-rounded, full system, full performance. So you leave out bhava, which is exactly why Krishna is, T.M. Krishna is talking so much about, he divorced it from Solkattu and the Melams and all that. That is an attempt to destroy the lyrical tradition as well.
So exactly. I will come to that because he has got very prolific things to say. One comment which you made also is that about his performing kacheri, giving proper kacheri, which also has got to, come to a very shoddy show, because there have been in the recent past where he has just done the alapana and then he has quit the stage, saying that itself is enough. So all this experiment that he's...
I'll just pause you there because this is exactly what Arvind Kejriwal does. Spit and run, shoot and scoot. And I'll do this alapna and run off. Then I've seen some kacheris where he's deliberately brings in Muslims and Christians and tries to do some kind of cinematic effect and all that nonsense. So that he's lost his stature as a proper Carnatic singer. And what he does on stage is both ideology and politics.
Theatrics. Totally. So, in that case, what I'm inspired to get to know from you, he was a closet urban Naxal. What's your take?
That comes in the realm of speculation and conjecture and all the other things. But I have been kind of more or less observing the musical scene. Because on and off, I also tune into these things. This metamorphosis has occurred over the last, 15 years. And then it has escalated after he won the Magsaysay Award, which everybody is familiar with. And the first salvo that he fired was in a long-form essay that he wrote for Caravan. That is out and out Maoist publication. So that piece was a below the belt disgusting attack against M.S. Subbulakshmi. And T.M. Krishna is a bully and a coward, like every communist is. If he had the guts, he would have written it when M.S. Subbulakshmi was alive. She is no longer alive to either defend herself or call his bluff. What would he do when he, as long as she was alive? He would either, fake his respect for her, or he would maintain a respectable distance. But now that she's dead, he does a full cover story, basically abusing her. He doesn't use filthy language, but the import is the same. I don't want to, spoil my tongue by repeating what he said that there. So that was the first salvo that he fired. And after that, obviously, with the Magsaysay and the rest of the thing, all this promotions, international and national promotions by all leftist platforms, he began to escalate it, like I said. So now the next step in this Breaking India Forces, Urban Naxal thing, somewhere down the line, in my limited studies of communist ideology, Naxal ideology, they're all the same, they're nothing different, is that it is targeted at something very fundamental in our psyche. Like I said, at the level of emotion, not at level of emotion, sorry, at the level of the intellect and the ego. So when you have an ideology that says that only our ideology is right, it's the same like our monotheism, that only we are right, our religion is the best religion, everything else is false. It is not only false, that we have to either convince them to come to see the light, to see this wisdom, or you have to kill them. Basically, communism is also derivative of both these monotheisms, except that communism is Islam without Quran and Christianity without Bible. But Karl Marx is there, Tin Pot God, and Das Kapital and Communist Manifesto is there, Quran and Bible respectively. It doesn't have a central God. So where it is attractive is that it appeals to ego. So now E.M. Krishna comes from an extremely privileged background. And precisely if you look at the history of communism over the last century or so, communists got funding, they expanded their ideology by cultivating filthy rich businessmen. And how would they convince them? By appealing to the ego. So whether Krishna was a closet urban Naxal or whether he was always like this is again a matter of speculation. When the switch happened, we don't know. But one thing I can tell you here is that Carnatic classical music especially was the last bastion which the communists could not penetrate. For the longest time, they penetrated art, they penetrated painting, they penetrated, of course, literature, drama, performing arts, theater, everything. But Carnatic classical music especially, they could not penetrate. Why? Because, you know, what revolution? I remember S.L. Bhairappa's version, I'm quoting him. What social or communist revolution can you achieve by singing a 3-hour alapana of Bhairavi? Right? So how do you achieve revolution is by provoking the masses for violence. Now, when I listen to a 3-hour alap of Bhairavi or Revati or Charukeshi or anything, it will put me in such a divine mood. Right, so this is the exact antithesis. So when Krishna was recruited, or he recruited himself, that we don't know what went on behind the scenes. But when he was recruited, he could not destroy this raga system, this pure alap, abstract alap that can come only from the depth of your feeling. And even swaraprasarams, but that is different. So that relates more to the grammar than to feeling. So he could not destroy this part of it. So what could he destroy? What were the targets that, you know, you could destroy? Is that, you know, you take a whole and isolate a few parts which you think can be effectively attacked. So you start attacking M.S. Subbulakshmi. You start attacking the lyrical tradition. You say that, you know, Tyagaraja was a revolutionary. Now they'll equate Tyagaraja with Marx, with Karl Marx, like they try to equate Swami Vivekananda with Marx. So, I mean, all kinds of fault lines or imaginary fault lines, basically they are isolated elements from within a larger whole, which they will single out and attack or twist it to suit their ideology, their whatever narrative as appropriate. And then they'll start harping on it and build, you know, tons of books and articles and documentaries and interviews and seminars, the rest of the thing. We are all familiar with those tactics. So this is how they do it. So you cannot, attack something like Alapana. So next, what you do? You make a kind of a corpus and say that, you know, in off late, and, you know, this whole thing about only Brahmins monopolizing a Carnatic music is completely false. Because only a few names in the last about a century or so, prominent names have all been Brahmins, doesn't mean that, you know, we have a history of more than 1,000 years of pure music. How many Brahmins were there? You have to look at it that far. You can't be selective in, you know, picking your favorite targets, but this is what they do. So you isolate them and attack each individual part, building, you know, force fitting it into your narrative. Does that answer your question?
That of course answers the question, and you have anticipated many of my other questions as well. But anyway, it's a in the tradition that you mentioned, that it comes from a very privileged tradition, and of course you have mentioned about it in your article also, in the Dharma Dispatch. But one point that I find very funny or amusing is that Actually, if you go back to the Tamil Isai movement of late 50s, there are two factions. And apparently, in the music academy, the faction which was opposing the Tamil Isai at that time was that was a pedigree from which our T.M. Krishna comes, actually. But anyway,
I agree. Yes, yes. I'm familiar with it. Yes. Yeah.
So, my next question, some slightly on similar lines, is that it is commonly discussed, even among well-meaning rasikas of Carnatic music, that ever since the music and dance came out of the temple and got commercialized, the musicians have been behaving in an erratic manner. T.M. Krishna takes support of this point and escalates his attacks even further. How do you view this?
Okay, now let me come to this Tamil Isai thing because I can't resist answering that. Is that it? See, Tamil Isai could, something like Tamil Isai movement, our musical tradition was never a movement. So the moment you add the word, moment you qualify it with another, word, movement, right? It means that you're trying to add color to it. Now, in the common parlance, when you use the word movement, there is A, an ideological connotation, or B, a political connotation, or C, both. So, Tamil Isai movement could not have arisen but for the political dominance of the Dravidian ideology. Yes? Because, like I said, this long musical tradition in India had compositions not just in one language, right? We have musical compositions in as many prominent Indian languages that we have. And Tamil is one of the prominent Indian languages. Why do you need to kind of say that? I mean, during those days, I think in the starting from late 40s and all the way up to even 70s, I think, if I'm not mistaken, is that it was became kind of mandatory for quote unquote Brahmin musicians to compulsorily sing Tamil compositions, which were kind of some of the, which were devoid of the Hindu Kritis compositions on our gods and that come in our tradition. So, but has the Tamil Isai movement, musical movement, has it endured? Has it endured in the same fashion that Muthuswami Dikshitar or Jayadeva or Narayan Guru or any of those guys, that tradition, people who have come from that tradition? There is a quality, long lasting, and a quality of endurance in this tradition. Because like they declared, they were just following the tradition. And by doing that, they also became immortal. Now, you can't just, cook up something like a Tamil Isai tradition, or I can't say I have a Sandeep school of music or something, and demand, and I have a minister's backing, so demand that Sandeep's composition has to be sung everywhere. Of course, they will sing it because they're forced or whatever, or their livelihood depends on it. But will it endure after my own lifetime? No. So, okay. Leaving that aside, sorry, I forgot your question.
Good that you actually dwelt in Tamil Isai. If I may, with your permission, just add a little bit. The Tamil Isai movement, of course, it had the Dravidian ideological quality behind it. No doubt about that. But then, it actually, the musicians of that time, as you rightly said, they were forced to sing a certain thing. It goes to the extent, it is in records, that All India Radio, they were rationing the time. It was actually championed by Agatappa Chettiar, who rationed, who gave, how much time should be devoted to Tamil music, how much time to this music. That aside, but the point that I wanted to make was, it had its startup problems. But then eventually that the performing musicians got into their repertoire, and it was kind of, even to this day, if you see a concert, there will be 30% to 40% of all the well-meaning musicians singing some Tamil songs in it. They have no qualms about it. But the problem started when the same Dravidians saw that the Tamil Isai movement was hijacked by the Brahmins. Because they saw that it was, again, the Brahmins who were dominating all the Tamil scene. They started a splinter group. They called it as Tandai Periyar Tamil Isai Movement.
Yeah.
That is where they kind of promoted, you know, only atheistic music and atheist musicians. That splinter group has gone to compete. Anyway, that is one point that I wanted to make. The question was that ever since this music and dance came out of temple, the musicians started behaving erratically. And T.M. Krishna takes this point in his favor. So how do you view this? That was my question.
No, again, this is again, this goes back to his ideology. I mean, you can't. Krishna, it's a good question, a wonderful question. Actually, Krishna seems to have this penchant for saying, you know, okay, after X, a great thing happened, because of this, Y happened, and then one more great explosion happened, after this, Z happened. It doesn't work like that. It is not just music that he has to look at. You have to look at the entire political history, the economic conditions, and the cultural changes that happened, which flows in a current. Right? Then suddenly there's some eruption happens, but then it also dies down. I mean, what changes are good, bad, that is separate. But you can't isolate it like that. You have to take a complete view of it. So that complete view, what does it inform? Our traditional music was not limited or restricted only to, you know, courts of kings and zamindars and palegas, or only in the temples. That is not true at all. Even today, musicians, classical musicians are invited to sing at weddings. They come with their whole group with a pakkavadyam. They still sing in temples without remuneration. They sing in, give private kacheris. Some take remunerations for that, chamber concerts and all that. Some don't take it. Right? And it has always been this tradition. How many great accomplished musicians, violinists, veena vidwans, they would sit somewhere in the, by the riverside. This was a common scene. Look at movies, yeah? Like this great saintly musician. He would be, all looking almost like a beggar, but he'll be a great singer, singing alone, sitting by the riverside. What nonsense is this? So, and they didn't become erratic musicians. Look, there's nothing like erratic musicians. People are erratic by nature. I'm also erratic. Okay. So, he's a musician, but he's also an erratic person. And these people have been around for a long time. I mean, we have had legends, legendary stories of, great musicians who compete with each other. Both are highly egoistic. We have this beautiful novel in Kannada called Hamsagite. You might have watched the movie also. It was made into a movie by GVIR. So where, there is a competition between the guru and Shishya. And the guru loses and he commits suicide. So what erratic? This is not erratic. This is erratic. So this much can be said is that, the patronage for classical music had remained intact for a long time. And as the Hindu society became more and more de-Hinduized, this patronage was completely destroyed. So people who would look at classical music as a way to attain divinity or, whatever, bhakti, whatever you want to call it, nana, whatever, the regular yoga, nada yoga, kala yoga, whatever, dana, whatever it is. Like these pristine traditions, that as the Hindu society became cut off progressively from its roots, everything that revolved and germinated from those roots also became cut off, including classical.
Very true. I mean, you have very nice, beautifully explained it. It's just that it's a straw man's argument that these people resort to. If there is some...
No, it is not even an argument, Raman. What they are doing is that they are using classical music like they did with Ramayanam, like they did with our Puranas stories and all that. They want something, they want to destroy it, so they pick something and then they hammer it relentlessly. They don't even have an argument. Now, apart from T.M. Krishna, how many other classical musicians are doing this circus show that he's doing. He's the only one.
I have some points on that, but I'll come to that later, because now he has generated a small battery of army behind himself. Yeah. And will come to that later. Point.
Okay, sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
On the patronage part, again, it's a very beautiful point that, you know, when Tyagaraja, when he composes Nidhi Chala Sukhama and then Sannidhi Chala Sukhama, they didn't actually bother for those patronages. But the music, or even Muthuswami Dikshitar, Hiranmayi and Lakshmi, actually, he says that I will not go with the Hina Manava, who is going behind the money. So from that pedestal, actually, we have come, and this is the music which these people sing and get the money also. That's a different issue.
Absolutely.
Although in the beginning, let me ask you one other question. Although in the beginning, we agreed, I still agree that Bharatiya Sangeeta is what? But it's only later that now we have divided this into Carnatic music and Hindustani music. But this is the current parlance that is well, got well established. But then I observe a very interesting thing here. In all his taking down of Carnatic music, he is completely silent on Hindustani classical music. Why do you think so? What is your take on it?
I mean, I think I've written on this. It's the answer is straightforward. Hindustani music, even today, to a large extent, is dominated and preserved by Muslims. Muslims in India, the same Hindustani music, Hindustani classical music, what happened to it when it went to Pakistan? Within 50 years, it was decimated. And Muslims are preserving Hindustani or Indian classical music here only because the overall cultural ambience, civilizational roots in India are Hindu. That is why Muslims are able to preserve Indian classical music or Hindustani music in India. So that is one area. These guys are very smart, Raman. People like T.M. Krishna, whatever you can accuse of, you can't accuse him of being dumb. They know exactly where they have to draw the line. So that is the reason he cannot and he will not criticize Hindustani classical music. It's as simple as that. And the division, and I'm just kind of making a historical hypothesis, it could be wrong as well. The division of Indian classical music into Hindustani and Carnatic somewhere became, kind of more pronounced with the deeper inroads of Muslims in North India up to the Vindhyas. So that whole, there is a distinct divide. It's almost like they're two separate schools, which they're not. But then, their approach to our music, classical music and our system are totally distinct. So there are intersections, and like I said, Balmurli is one who has kind of seen this intersection, this point, meeting point, blending point, and he has used the best of both schools in his overall body of work, musical work. So this is the reason, again, that Krishna will never criticize Hindustani classical music. Because that means the Muslim lobby will be upset, which the Marxists, the communists will never do. They are the closest buddies or whatever. And the whole, syncretic culture, the Ganga Jamuni Tehzeeb, Hindustani classical music is also one part of that Ganga Jamuni Tehzeeb. So all that will be threatened. If he plays the same stunts that he's playing here with Carnatic, that whole thing will fall down and he stands to lose the most.
Yeah, that's a very brilliant answer. As a follow-up or as an add-on, what I would like to ask is, yes, indeed he's playing safe and he's playing very smart. But then when that art and a true artist, a devotee of art, transcends all different barriers, why is it that well-meaning Hindustani classical musicians, I'm not talking about the Ganga Jamuni Tehzeeb followers, but there are in the Hindustani group also some well-meaning classical musicians who are apparently appearing to be stuck to the roots. Why are they not calling out this charade? Why is it that So outsiders from the music arena are able to see this and call out. Why are the Hindustani musicians who are stuck to the root are not seeing through it or are not willing to see through it? What's your take on that?
I agree with your last point. They are not willing to see through it. It's not, look, they are the ultimate insiders. Like, I mean, they're performing, you know, some of them are professional singers and professional performers. So somewhere down the line, and it has a lot to do with the Nehruvian system, which concentrated, which used political power as a patronage. Right? I mean, you can argue that, you know, in India, music was largely preserved through political patronage by, you know, praising rajas and getting jagirs and gifts from them. But those rajas were genuine connoisseurs and patrons of our music. They themselves were accomplished musicians. So they were insiders to the tradition in that sense. They were also deeply rooted people who built temples, so let alone music. So this Nehruvian system began to, you know, politicize music through the prism of his whatever secular ideology or whatever that is called. So once that happened, you create a certain sense of insecurity throughout, across the board. A Babu will not sign. He will not make a note. He will not sign. Why? Because you never know. Some minister who hates him or some politician who hates him might use just that one paragraph to harass him. So the same thing became applicable in the realm of music and art as well. So those who didn't fall line, their careers were ruined. They became impoverished. So silence was the best option. And just to, you know, kind of smile and agree with, even if some nonsense is being said and poor music and crap is being peddled in the name of music. So that is one. And the second thing is the fact that because it is largely controlled by or largely dominated by Muslims, there is also a certain sense of superiority and a kind of confidence. Now, I'm sure you've noticed this, is that some Hindustani musicians from a long time, they have a certain condescending attitude towards Carnatic classical music. Karnataki hai. For a long time, Charukeshi was forbidden to be sung. And what is known as Bairagi Bairav, Revati Ragam, that was not incorporated in Hindustani. These are all recent additions to their tradition. So one thing is that they had this one confidence. And the second thing is that, why do you want to create unnecessary, enemies? Let Krishna is doing something, let him do it. And who knows, Krishna might open a few doors, some 10 USA tour, Kacheri tour for these Hindustani guys. A lot of factors play. So what you're talking about, musical exploration, purity, those guys are still there, but they used to be the moral force around which people like PM, like I said, no, I gave you the example of M.S. Subbulakshmi. Krishna never dared open his mouth. Why? Because of the sheer force of a personality. And what she brought to the table, so to say, what she had overall contributed to the cultural ambience of Carnatic music. So when you have, I mean, she's somewhere there. So you can't even think of, you know, abusing someone like that. So these are basically, he's a musical necromancer. People who eat dead bodies, basically.
And to just quote you, I think you call him the Arundhati Roy of classical music.
Totally. So yeah, that is my take.
That's true. So just continuing a little bit on that, about the patronage part, when it comes to the patronage thing, as you rightly said, the patronage is there. My question I want to ask is, art thrives not in isolation, but only with copious patronization. If the kings and temples of yesteryears were the chief patrons, today, all said and done, it is the sabhas. In most of, I'm sure even in Karnataka also, Tamil Nadu or mostly Chennai, it is the sabhas. With increasing commercialization, What do you think will be the practical solution that will weed off such malice from the field? See, let me give you one context based on which what I'm asking. Now, like-minded people of T.M. Krishna are not just in music circle or politics, but they may be even in business people who may own the Sabha, who may, you know, rightly kind of dictate terms or conduct the Sabhas. So how do you see, this again is speculation, but then futuristic speculation it is. Because what will happen if the patronage comes mainly from Sabhas, and if like-minded people of TMK are going to handle the Sabhas, how do you view the future?
Well, like you said, it's speculative, but I don't know. Look, the point is that we don't largely have the Sabha culture in Karnataka is not, at least in Bangalore, is not as dominant as, you know, and as central as it is in Chennai, at least. I mean, it's almost like the hub for all classical musicians across South India, the Sabha system. Now, a couple of things. The commercialization, towards what end and at what intensity? Now, there has been a tendency to kind of glamorize Carnatic classical music, which is visible everywhere, right? And there has definitely been a massive degeneration, even in the quality of singing and the, you know, the flair of the concerts that are being rendered there. So it is a dismal situation. It is like, you know, chicken and egg problem again. Now, the Sabhas, which had played a role, which had kind of replaced the Zamindars and the king and temple patronage, what is their fidelity? What is the extent of their, you know, devotion and their rootedness in Sanatana Dharma? That is a main factor. That is a chief factor that will determine the future of this whole thing. And if people like T.M. Krishna, you know, they become dominant and start handling these sabhas, he will achieve his stated objective of destroying classical music. In its present shape and form, and rich business people who own and, you know, contribute generously to these sabhas, they are largely what you call non-committal or maintain a kind of safe distance from controversies. Because let's face it, yeah, they stand to lose a lot. It is not an ideal situation and it is a hostile situation, especially in a state like Tamil Nadu, in a city like Chennai, where Dravidianism has, I'm even surprised that these sabhas still exist. That they were not rooted out like, you know, literature, like writers and other cultural aspects in Tamil Nadu, like temples, for example. They're in a horrible state. So I'm actually surprised that these sabhas still exist. So over a period, this deracination, this de-Hinduization has eaten the system from within. Now, who was that? I mean, I wrote about this controversy, all the O.S. Arun and people singing, Nitya Shri singing for, you know, this gospel music or, you know, on Jesus for the church and all that. You wouldn't even dare dream. I mean, someone even 50, 60 years ago wouldn't dream of doing something like this. You can't twist a Tyagaraja Kriti and add Jesus and Christ to it. It was unthinkable because the roots were somewhere within. That is gone. So whatever the Sabha culture that exists will reform or will kind of be rejuvenated in direct proportion to their rootedness in the Sanatana tradition. That is the only answer I can think of right. It has to come from within. It has to come from within. The alternative is to create individuals, give them patronage, and make them work towards excellence. The greatest example, and I'll come back again, is Balmurali Krishna. I mean, at his peak, the number of detractors that he had, I'm sure you are aware of, all the controversies and attacks against him and everything. The same people before, 15 years before he died, would come and fall at his feet and say, "Sir, please bless me." So this is a great example of individuals endowed with excellence, devotion, passion, and conviction. So when these people, such individuals are given patronage, they create another entire generation of similar individuals. So institutions will work really well as long as it is manned by people who either respect such excellence and promote it, or foster this culture of excellence. Otherwise, it's the usual thing of politics, you know, factionism, money, whatever. Usual stuff. This is all I can think of.
Yeah, thank you. So that is the if I summarize your this answer, the acid test with which we can test these people is, are they rooted in the Sanatana Dharma, dharmic principles or not? That is the thing. But with your permission, if I may just add a thing, Tamil Nadu, all said and done, is a very funny place from different dimensions. Although it's my home state, I come from there. The concept of, you know, plagiarizing Tyagaraja Kriti had done even 100 to 150 years before. There are people like Vedanayagam Pillai, Abraham Pandidar. These were people, when the evangelical mission had, you know, rooted in Tanjavur, they had different ways to go about. And they had penetrated this field right from 1860s or 1870s, if I am not wrong, from that time onwards. And then it didn't actually surface out. Actually, in the language of natural selection, if one may have to use, they were there, but then they were not in the mainstream. They were there in the sidelines. But now what is happening
It has happened for a fundamental reason. The progressive de-Hinduization. We have created at least two generations or two and a half generations of Hindus who are not only not ashamed of classical music and their roots, but they actively are going out to destroy it. So they are doing the work of Christian missionaries. By being practicing Hindus or whatever it is, they are doing the work of Christian missionaries. This de-Hinduization and the progressive growth and political clout of the Christian lobby. So, like I said, your Abraham Panditar and all that, they were in the fringes because the Hindu society was very strong in that time.
That's perfectly right. I mean, these singers becoming as agents of these evangelists, so to say. They are actually singing, but they are becoming agents of these evangelists. That makes me ask you this question because, see, when I am a useful idiot, sometimes I may not know that I'm a useful idiot. I'm handled by somebody else. Where intelligence or, you know, pursuit of something drives me. Or sometimes money drives me. Whenever it is money which is driving me, then I'm aware of myself being a useful idiot. When there is a pseudo-intellectual pursuit, I'm not even aware that I'm a useful idiot. So when, you know, some of the singers, in this case, of course, D.M. Krishna belongs to a different category, but the other singers whom you mentioned fall in the same bracket, O.S. Arul or Nityashree, and there were a charade of, I mean, a battery of people who even wrote after the Me Too movement. All these people, are they doing it without any conscious awareness or because they are useful idiots? What I mean to ask is, what is the driving force? Is it a pseudo-intellectual pursuit for fame or is it money? What do you think, sir?
It's a combination of all, and I think we have to look at it on an individual case-to-case basis. You know, what drives a Nityashree to twist the Tyagaraja Kriti to praise Jesus and all that. I don't think it is money in her case. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. Maybe it is just the whole thing that, you know, this whole secular poison pill that, you know, we have to fall in line with what the rest of the world is saying. You have to conform. It could be that also. And in case of T.M. Krishna, neither of it. He's a committed ideologue. And that comes because, I don't know, I'll make a conjecture. Because of some deep-seated, uncured psychosis. could be that. Largely in his case, nothing else explains it. He could have, you know, been useful to society. He's subverting, trying to subvert an entire beautiful, noble culture. And in service of what? If you're destroying something, if I'm destroying wheat, right? If I'm destroying some, you know, pest or something, there is a specific purpose. It is to preserve my land. What is he doing this for? And destroying something as beautiful as classical music. So there's a deep-seated psychosis, maybe some kind of neurosis that has no cure. So in his case, this is the answer. And communists and Marxists recruit, left liberals recruit precisely such people. Plus, he has a lot of money, comes from a privileged background. So whatever he does, nobody criticizes, except, you know, his tirade against M.S. Subbulakshmi. Then the rest of the Carnatic guys somehow suddenly developed a spine and condemned him or whatever. But otherwise, this is a case. And plus, I think they're all deeply insecure at some level. And, you know, if I don't, you know, if I'm not counted in these right, correct circles, proper fashionable circles, somehow I will lose my next concert opportunity. And the trend over the last 20 years has been that, you know, film music directors, these people have become, you know, they have been frequently singing in films. Whereas it was, even during Ilaiyaraja's time, film music was looked down upon. That's a different argument. So the point is that there is tradition, and then film music is looked at as a deviation from this pristine tradition. That's a different argument. But the element of this cultural rootedness is where it comes from. So a lot of explanations, neurosis, you know, fame, money, all of the above, some of the above.
Yeah, that's a very brilliant point. In fact, even when you make differentiate between cinema music and real concert music, that's again in the yester years when people like G.N. Balasubramaniam or M.S. Subbulakshmi, or for that matter even D.K. Pattabhan or M.L. Mari, when they sang, they made sure that the context, the lyrics, everything, the ambience was more spiritual and nothing of
devotional
and nothing of lustful or whatever the cinematic masala they had.
Right.
Then again, in the book, T.M. Krishna actually takes this point again and attacks them, saying that what classicism is this when they had sung for even cinema and stuff like that. But anyway. So, of course, he had written, and you made also a very succinct point that when the attack happens, especially in the case of M.S. Subbulakshmi, suddenly some other musicians realize that they shoulder some responsibility and they have to respond. But in the event of M.S. Subbulakshmi after the caravan episode, it's actually, in fact, to my knowledge, I mean, I'll be happy to stand corrected, that it was only one musician who kind of rebutted in return. Vis-a-vis, when there was a Me Too charade, there were you know, a battery of musicians who were signatories of the letter, taking one side. Krishna, they were taking side to the T.M. Krishna, and there was one letter. You had also written about it in your article.
Yeah.
So this divide, when you have to, you know, defend your own system, defend your own roots, only one comes up. Whereas when you have to take the opposite stand, you already have a battery of people. How do you view this? Is it the success of T.M. Krishna's propaganda, or how do you see this?
I won't see it as a success of his propaganda, but the fact is that these performing arts, film, entertainment, that business is overwhelmingly dominated by left liberals. And you can't survive in that industry by openly declaring your sympathy as a practicing Hindu, or by making critical comments of about Islam and Christianity or whatever. You're familiar with all that. So these are all career people. And the Me Too movement should rank as, you know, Himalayan hypocrisy. I mean, it is a definition of hypocrisy. Where did the so-called Me Too movement originate? In Hollywood. Film people talking about, you know, sexual harassment is like, I don't know, yaar. I mean, celebrating Ram Navami in Pakistan or something. That is the best analogy. And all these singers, all these signatories for T.M. Krishna's nonsense, that other ladies, that shrill lady is there. What's the name? That classical singer.
Chinmay.
Now she's a film singer.
Chinmay.
Chinmay, yeah. Yeah, that shrill woman. I mean, what were these people doing? If you know, what were these people doing all these years? Yeah. What were they doing? So film people and these guys talking about Me Too and sexual harassment is, you know, it's hilarious actually. You can make a parody film out of this Me Too movement. So that is one. And to address your question about, you know, this guy's, T.M. Krishna's success of his propaganda, he obviously comes from that milieu. And you have to align with him. Otherwise, your career is gone. And in the entertainment business, in this whole music business, I mean, it's you know, unconsciously, subconsciously, we attach the word industry and business to these arts. So their entire career will be ruined. So it is also another way of saying, look, I also signed this Me Too movement. So give me 10 films instead of one film. Be seen, you know, to be seen with the right kind of people, mouthing the right kind of, you know, verbiage. So that is also a big contributor to all these things.
Thank you. That was, I was tempted to, you know, compare this Chinmayi's movement. If you, you have also very succinctly covered it in your article. That first she started with using
Vairamuthu.
Where, you know, everybody started cheerleading her. Then, from the right wing or from quote unquote right wing, it was actually saying she is. But then when she turned sides, that was when the real attack was felt.
Yes.
This is a time tested technique by, you know, the attackers. Because I'm reminded of the similar movement in Tamil Nadu by the Dravidians, who, you know, started all this E.V. Ramaswamy, who started chappaling, putting garland on. Chappal garland Rama. Actually, what had happened was this Adinams, Shaiva Adinams, they were aligning with those people. But then later, when the same Dravidians started attacking the Shaiva Adinam also, and that is when they realized that, fine, they are not going to stop at anything, it is going to engulf the entire religious milieu. So, Me Too Sharad was also something similar.
No, this is exactly, I mean, if you read medieval Indian history or Muslim history of medieval India, this is exactly the tactic. First they will, you know, common enemy, you know, friend, enemy's enemy is a friend, so if you align with those people, then they'll, when they're strong enough, they'll turn on you and eat you. This is, so that's why, you know, you have to be, see, truth, we have to stick only to the truth. It is the hardest thing to do, but it is the only thing that will, you know, give you insights and give you clarity on how you should proceed with regard to issues or other things, politics, whatever it is. So you can't make these temporary compromises and support opportunistically, and then in the same tongue, you can't blame the person for doing what he or she did, in this case, Chinmayi. The same lady, I remember long back when she was still a struggling singer, she would be whining publicly. You know, my career is, you know, a lot of powerful people are trying to suppress me and this and that. Now, why didn't she attack Vairamuthu 10 years back? 15 years back?
Yeah, that's again nice coverage. Perhaps this is my last question.
Okay. And,
this is again from a very abstract, it may look like a speculation, but I just want to pick your brain on what's your thought on this. When we look at it from a civilizational point of view, the Nada Shastra or the Sangeeta, it's actually produced giants, Jambavans, mm-hmm. like Sangeeta Pitamaha, Purandara Dasa, or Mubba Gopala, Uthakad Venkata Subbaiya. These are all some prominent names that we get from pre-Trinity time. Then we had the Trinity, Tyagaraja, Dikshitar and Shama Shastri. Post-Trinity also, we have some very stalwart names. But then the same culture, the same thing has now produced a person like T.M. Krishna. So where and what has gone wrong? Your take on this.
I'll have to correct you gently. The same tradition has not produced T.M. Krishna. He is a...
I get what you mean. Yeah, I get what you mean. That's nice.
He is a violator of that tradition who unfortunately was born into it. Because we can't choose our birth. We can't choose our parents. This has happened. And as far as he's concerned, the objective is clear. Where he calls, we have to take classical music to Dalits and slums and all that. Two questions. One, which Dalit or which slum dweller was clamoring that, Krishna, come and rescue us. We want to learn classical music. No, it is an inner calling. I am sure in today's world, in India, across the world, there is no classical music teacher who will refuse to teach a person from so-called non-upper caste. I'm sure there's no such teacher. And there hasn't been any such teacher in our tradition. The Nadaswara musical tradition, who preserved it? The so-called upper caste. A lot of these percussion musical traditions also. Who preserved it? You can reel out n number of names. The temple melams in their original pristine condition. It's not that you take vocal only and restrict it to some Brahmin sabhas and allege an upper caste conspiracy. No. One entire festival, during festival time, for example, say in Tanjavur or Madurai or in Mysore, there was no Varnabeda in that sense. There's no discrimination in that sense. It was a service of deity. If this fellow, T.M. Krishna, had understood ABC of Sanatana Dharma, the first thing that he would have understood is that when you go out on a Tirtha Yatra, there is no Varnabeda. If that's what he will know, his idea of what he calls as Dalit liberation, no, nonsense. He wants to appoint himself as some kind of cultural liberator of these people. People who are not on their own accord, they are not looking to be liberated.
Exactly. So the using postmodernist tools and jargons to retrofit our scriptures or our shastras has been a kind of a pseudo-intellectual pursuit of many academics. And I think he is towing the similar lines. I'm also interested to raise up, and you have covered it in your article, but then would like to also hear it again here, about the kind of attack that he had on M.S. Subbalakshmi. Of course, you talked about it before also. But then he tried to convey multiple thoughts through that, because it is not just an attack on M.S. Subbalakshmi, it's also an attack on G.N. Balasubramanian.
Yes.
And it is also highlighting how patriarchal oppressive society it was. So how do you view this, the episode of him attacking M.S. Subbalakshmi and G.N. Balasubramanian? And overall,
Sadashiv also.
Of course, Sadashiv. Because also. He says that it is she was only programmed by him, and all that he said had to be strictly obeyed by her. In the same context, you just have briefly mentioned about he often mentioning that Brahmins have hijacked this music. So can you dwell deeper into that? Why is this obsession about the Brahmin hatred? Of course, communists have got the Brahmin hatred thing. But then his angle of Brahmins hijacking the music and they are ruling the roost. Little bit more of your thoughts on into that.
Well, I mean, it's fairly clear that, you know, no matter what, for the longest time, Brahmins have been the cultural custodians. In what sense? In the sense that they can give a grammar to a practice. Right? Now, when you worship a stone, when you carve, you know, a murti of some devata, it is still a stone, right? But when is the divinity imputed to it? You can still do your puja, you know, put some flowers and milk and all that. But there is a grammar that should be written around it, that should govern this. Right? I mean, I can say, I'm still speaking some language, no, except that you don't understand it. There is no difference between this sound and whatever I said earlier. So that is why you need a grammar, a kind of a system. And then when you impute divinity to it, and you have a small kind of a fit method and a pattern which is both repeatable, verifiable, and which can be transmitted. This is grammar. And this eventually, you know, branches out and takes different forms. Like, just like how language has poetry and lyrics and prose and drama and everything. Right? Everything emanates from that. In the same way, Brahmins became the cultural custodians. Because, you know, if you have to replicate something, you have to understand its grammar. So for a long time, this is how it was. And, you know, it was not that, you know, Brahmins were always, you know, kept on a pedestal. The whole atrocities of Brahmins against lower caste, I'm telling you, is largely exaggerated. It is nothing compared to, say, how Muslims treated Kafirs, or blacks were treated by, you know, whites or whatever it is. Take the system of slavery, for example. We never had this. At the most, what was the so-called caste atrocity? At the most, what was it? They won't allow you into temples or, you know, go to the wells and all that. But this, again, there was a fluidity in the so-called Varna system for a long time. It was only when these brutal attacks came that to preserve your own tradition and your way of life that the identities became hardened. Now, there is a small subsect of, I think, Gonds or Bills, tribes in Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, that belt. They trace their descendants to Maharana Pratap, who was hiding in the forest for some time. So, today they are classified as, I think, scheduled tribes. But when they trace their ancestry back, they are what is known as upper caste today, Kshatriyas. So you can't, I mean, this again, he's a Marxist and a hardcore communist. So we don't need to take him, you know, his fulmination seriously. And coming to your point about M.S. Subbalakshmi and GNB and Sadashivam and all that. M.S. Subbalakshmi herself was a Devadasi. What do you make of it? And he mentions that, you know, unless she Brahminized herself, she won't get respect. I'll ask you, with even a rudimentary knowledge of M.S. Subbalakshmi's life, on what basis can you make this kind of claim? On lived experience? On her public behavior? In her music? On what basis can you derive this kind of filthy conclusion? Yeah? That whole article, you know, this is typical communist method. And I'll give you an example. Is that you pick someone who is revered by everybody for a long time. And then you target them and abuse them in the filthiest language, which eventually boils down to sex and extramarital affairs or whatever it is. So we have in Telugu, I'll give you Telugu literature, for example. You have a beautiful work called Ramayana, some Mahavrikshamo, I think. I forget the name, but it's a magnum opus of Vishwanatha Satyanarayana. So to counter that, one hardcore communist lady, she wrote a book called Ramayana Vishavriksham. Okay. So then the same thing happened in the early years when the, you know, communists began to enter, infiltrate literature. You take Sita and you allege that she had an affair with Lakshmana. You take Draupadi, you allege that she had an affair with Karna. So this is the same template. So you take M.S. Subbulakshmi and allege whatever you want to, this kind of, you know, below the belt attack. So they have a few set templates, and if you understand these templates, you will understand the public actions and writing and whatever activism by people like him. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, it answers. It's just that I wanted it to be even more elaborate, and rightly you did that. After that, M.S. Subbulakshmi, he has actually gone even a step ahead. Because in his previous work and book, of course, he brings about this, the non-existent line of caste line. And with your permission, if I may add also, one of the prominent disciples of Muthuswami Dikshitar's were the Tanjavur quartet, Chinnaya, Ponnaya, Shivanandam and Vadivelu.
Shivanandam, yeah.
They were not Brahmins. In fact, one of the Devadasis was herself a Shishya of Muthuswami Dikshitar. Those are examples to show that whatever caste line, as I said, the postmodern jargons that these people use to retrofit our Shastras, they're all wrong. But then coming to this point, in his recent book, he has gone a step ahead, where, you know, he goes behind the percussion artist. Earlier attack was on the prominent vocalists and instrumentalists. Now it's specifically the percussion artist, because, okay, meat consumption is a taboo, but then the same, you go after the animal for its skin, and you do not treat the people who make this instrument for you in the same way as you're supposed to treat, so on and so forth. I didn't follow that book very deeply, because after the first book, that was enough for me. And the whole theme of the second book is that you want to use their service of converting the animal skin into a good mridangam, but at the same time, you don't want to give that equal respect to the mridanga maker. So your takes on those aspects.
Yeah, nothing. I mean, it is just a variation of the same thing that he did with M.S. Subbulakshmi. Ultimately, what is the aim? It is, like I said, to destroy Carnatic music by isolating specific elements and attacking them. You cannot directly attack the quote-unquote caste of these percussion music and, you know, get away with it. You can't do that. You simply can't do that. At least in Tamil Nadu, you can't do it. So what do? You destroy the music. What are you doing? You're trying to liberate these lower castes, no? How? By, doing activism against them and snatching their livelihood. Is that how you're liberating them? No, this is classic communist tactic. Yeah? I mean, isolating stuff. I mean, the whole playbook I can write on two-volume, work on these tactics. So this is how you do it. Either you attack the whole, but if the whole is very strong, you pick out specific weak points and go after them. That is the other thing. They are relentless. They are relentless, they are shameless, they are indecent. Are you telling me that Krishna, and the other thing is that people like PM Krishna will not engage with you in a logical debate? This is the thing. We have to remember that. They will not invite you to their forums. It is plain, pure ideological, muscle-bound propaganda. With a vengeance, they will not stop it. They're relentless. Yeah.
That is very true. They are relentless, they are indecent, and they are shameless, and they can go to any extent to attack whatever it may be. But in this, I also find that it is, of course, the tactics of communists, but then in India, and specifically Tamil Nadu and Carnatic music, it's also the evangelicals who are in hand in gloves with the communists in this. Because right from the 1870s or 1880s, whenever they started attacking the temples, it is their techniques that is also getting propagated. And in fact, not related to the exactly related to the topic, but then that's how the evangelicals movement, which started 1880s, ended up as the anti-Nudge movement or anti-Nudge bill by Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy.
Yes.
But then that
one short day of the Devadasis.
Yeah, of course. And but anyway, that perhaps that's again a topic of a different conversation, perhaps, and we'll take it up that on a different day.
It's a separate, yeah. It's an independent topic.
It's an independent topic there. Now I come back to the original initial thing that you actually started with about the Sahitya, that is, he separating out or disentangling the Sahitya from the Bhakti Bhava on that. So I just want to quote him. I quote, "The musician expresses every melodic motif as an extension of an appendage to the lyrical meaning and not as a distinct melodic import. That is when the music regretfully ceases to be art music. The shift in focus from melodic to lyrical meaning deeply affects the compositional experience for the listener. In my world of meaning, Kamakshi is a melodic and not a lyrical concept," unquote. This is what he says. And he alleges to something called art music and non-art music. Now, let me tell you, he is not the first one to propose that. Even earlier musicologists like Rangaramanuja Iyengar and all, if you look at the 50s, they have said what is art music and what is non-art music. So what is your take on that? Between art, non-art,
well,
and the DMK logic.
If he wants to say that, you know, this musical element as an appendage of the lyric, if he makes that claim, then what is the space for what is alapana then? What is alapana then? Right. So you do a 5-minute alapanam. And then you can write a lyric to fit that alapanam. That itself becomes a kriti, right? So, see, this whole division, artificial division, as art music and non-art music or whatever it is. There is just music and there's lyric, and the whole thing is art. You can't separate it like that, right? So again, like I said, by making this kind of distinction, you're destroying both the lyrical tradition and the musical tradition. As simple as that. So if Kamakshi is only just, what was that again?
Kamakshi is a melodic and not a lyrical concept.
What melody is there in Kamakshi? How? They won't answer these questions. How? Right? It's straightforward. I mean, you answer this. How?
Well, I don't agree with him. So that's why this is a difficult answer for me. But then,
it's complete nonsense. The point is that he wants to say undercurrent of this, the subtext of this is simple. By saying, this Kamakshi word is just a melodic component or whatever, he wants to remove or at least disengage the element of divinity in the word Kamakshi. You can't utter the name Kamakshi and not associate it with Parvati. It is simply impossible. This is what he's actually trying to do. The whole melodic thing and all that is just an excuse for this.
Exactly. I completely agree with you on that. I have no qualms in saying that. But then this, interestingly, what E.M. Krishna also mischievously does is this division of art and non-art, he takes recourse in, whom all the way until Nati Shastra, saying that it is the Gandharva and the Gana kind of division. He says, he attributes or he equates art to Gandharva and non-art to Gana music. But then for, that is again the deracinated public also. If a person is not well informed, this equation is actually wrong. What is defined in Nati Shastra as Gandharva and Gana has got nothing to do with this, with the way what M. Krishna differentiates art and non-art. Anyway, so that's just a point that I wanted to make. The other point that I wanted to also add to that was, this is a work not from music or anything, but this is from computational linguistics. This is by a paper in 2016, where they say something to this effect. I quote, "The bidirectional transfer of tonal categorization supports our theoretical prediction that domain-specific experience with categories may enhance domain-general category learning mechanisms, which in turn facilitate cross-domain categorization. These patterns suggest that experience which leads to increased efficiency of sound category learning could benefit the categorization in both music and speech under the domain general process." So even with modern science, they have proved that both the meaning of the word and the tonality of it are actually both necessary and sufficient to enhance your cognitive abilities. Which is what all the Vagyayakaras or singers have done in the past. And we have our T.M. Krishna, who has to say something that's completely opposite to this.
Yeah, he is a Swayambhu, right? So this is a whole thing that the left system appeals to your ego and your megalomania, and you know, gives you platforms to do this. He's just a political activist, no better than Arvind Kejriwal or Arundhati Roy or Ram Guha. They're all drinking buddies, maybe. So then they're nothing, beyond that, or nothing better than that.
I gently would like to differ with you on calling him Swayambhu, because in my intellectual perception, Swayambhu is always referred to Shivalinga, which is a Swayambhu. Yeah. Let us not equate into that. In Tamil, we have a very beautiful term, Tandoni. It is called
Tandoni.
It was the main same, but it is Tandoni. That is very, sorry to interrupt you.
No issues. So, I mean, he's just a political activist. We don't need to take him seriously, but we need to take him seriously because of the kind of damage that he has done and the potential for damage in future that he has and that he will do. So, I mean, if people like him, are relentless and, they just don't stop, I think they have to be responded to in time. But the point is, we draw a line at shame. They don't even have that line. Anyway, that will take us to a completely different discussion. So, yeah, this much can be said about
Krishna. My last
counter.
Go ahead.
The counter, like I said, is to create, individual artists, provide for them, whatever, lifelong or whatever, and make sure that this excellence is propagated. Like, if you want to aspire to climb the Himalaya, that aspiration itself is good. Even if you climb 30 or 40% of it, that itself is great. So when you create two or three generations of such aspirants, then I think we'll be good to go for the next 50 years. And no T.M. Krishna can, their damages can be continued. Unfortunately, that situation is not there.
I mean, you're optimistic. I kind of, I'm a experimentalist, and by nature, experimentalists have to be pessimist.
Yes,
that is where I kind of differ with you, because I also see other junior or upcoming contemporary musicians who are already towing the lines. They're either they throw their weight of Fulbright Fellowship or having one Carnatic Idol. They write into op-eds, towing the similar lines and kind of further perpetuating the damage. So that is something which we need to check. And again, it's like people like us here, mainly you and a little bit of that to this conversation, me here, who do not directly have skin in the game. We are the ones who are lamenting about it. But then it's high time that people who have skin in the game take up this mantle and live and call the spade a spade. Perhaps we'll have to see where it goes.
Yeah, that's where I'm optimistic. Unless you have optimism, I don't know. You can't carry it forward, is what I'm saying. You can't expect hope. If you have optimism, you derive hope from it.
That's a very good way of putting it. And in that case, in that note, we will end the conversation for recording.
We should.
Very nice speaking to you, Sandeep ji.
It's been wonderful. Very stimulating discussion, I must say. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and Atharva, for this.